Grace and peace be unto you from God our Father, from our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Today's gospel lesson reminds us of several things which, as Christians, we ought never forget, but many of the world willfully choose to forget. Jesus says, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and with all the holy angels with him, he will sit on the throne of his glory." He says, "When the Son of Man comes," not "if the Son of Man comes." And this very simple article of the Christian faith, so many willfully neglect and forget in our day. They observe one year closing and a new year beginning and assume that what has been will continue to be always. Or, on the other end of the spectrum, are those people that imagine that the world will end in some sort of planetary catastrophe, asteroid strike, nuclear war, something like that, and then poof, that will be the end of all things, and that's it. But Jesus teaches his disciples, not just in today's parable, but throughout his ministry, especially in the last week of his life before his crucifixion, that this world will come to an end, and that it will come to an end because he will bring it about when he returns in his glory. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, seated on his throne, surrounded by all his holy angels, then he says, all nations of the earth will be gathered to him. No one will be absent, for there will be no place to hide on that day. All those alive at that day will be gathered to Christ's throne. All those who have died before that day will be raised, no matter how they died, no matter how they were buried, no matter how long they had been dead. And then Christ, seated upon the throne of his glory, will separate them one from another as a shepherd divides his sheep from the goats. And he will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. St. John sees a picture of this in Revelation chapter 20 and writes, "I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books." Which leads us to the second thing that many willfully forget, and that is that we are judged by our works. Christ will say to the sheep on the right hand, "For I was hungry and you gave me food, I was thirsty and you gave me drink, I was a stranger and you took me in, I was naked and you clothed me, I was sick and you visited me, I was in prison and you came to me." And yet, to the goats on the left, he will say, "For I was hungry and you gave me no food, thirsty and you gave me no drink, a stranger and you did not take me in, naked and you did not clothe me, sick and in prison and you did not visit me." But the works of which Christ judges us and all mankind on that day, those are not the reasons for the sheep entering into everlasting life. They're not the reason why the goats will be sent off to everlasting fire that was prepared for the devil and his angels. Rather, he judges the works as witnesses, as outward visible testimonies of the faith in the heart, or the lack thereof. For all of these things are outward visible testimonies of faith in the heart of the sheep, and the lack of faith of the goats. Jesus says in John 3:18, "He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." Those who believe in Christ, that he is the eternal Son of God, who has made atonement for all sins and earned perfect righteousness and gives that to all who believe, they are not condemned. But those who in their life refuse to believe in the name of Christ, who he is, what he has accomplished for sinners, and what he offers to sinners in repentance and in the gospel, those who refuse to believe in Jesus' name, they stand already condemned in this life. The works of mercy that the sheep do for Christ's brethren Those don't earn them everlasting life. They are simply called as witnesses to the living faith that the sheep have in their hearts. Just as the lack of works of mercy are witnesses called against the goats to demonstrate that they had no faith in Christ during their earthly lives. That Christ gives everlasting life to the sheep out of sheer grace and pure mercy is demonstrated from the opening words of his verdict. He says, "Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." The kingdom was prepared before the foundation of the world and all things, not for a faceless class of people, but for the elect, for those whom God foresaw from eternity would believe in Christ and whose faith would endure until the end. The kingdom, dear saints, was prepared for you, he says. And it is given to the sheep as an inheritance, and an inheritance is unearned. It is undeserved. It is promised, not merited, not earned by one's works. Paul speaks similarly in Ephesians chapter 1. "He chose us in him," he writes, "in Christ, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he has made us accepted in the beloved," that is, in Jesus Christ. The sheep are given the kingdom, not because of their works, but by their faith in Christ, which made them sons and daughters of God the Father, and brothers and sisters of the Lord Jesus Christ. Which brings us to the next thing that so many often willfully forget from this text. The sheep respond to Christ's judgment with curiosity. They don't remember ever giving Christ food and drink. They don't recall them taking him into their homes, clothing him, visiting him when he was sick, or visiting him when he was imprisoned. But Jesus says that is precisely what they did. "Assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did it for one of the least of these, my brethren, you did it to me." The sheep, they served Christ in the person of their neighbor. But not just any neighbors, but specifically the neighbors who were Christ's brethren. And who are Christ's brethren? Jesus says in Matthew chapter 12, when someone tells him that his mother and brothers are waiting outside to speak with him, he says, "Who is my mother and who are my brothers?" And he stretched out his hand toward his disciples and said, "Here are my mother and my brothers. For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother." Those who do the will of the Heavenly Father, they are Christ's brethren. And we know from Scripture that the will of the Heavenly Father is that we believe on his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, as our Savior from sin, as the only mediator between us and God. We also know that the will of the Heavenly Father is our sanctification, that all who believe in his Son then would live holy lives in love for one another, especially for the brethren. Now, this is not to say that Christians ignore doing good for those who are not Christian or those who we are unsure of their spiritual state. For we love all the neighbors that God puts in our paths every day. But as St. Paul reminds us in Galatians 6, verse 10, and as we have a reminder of ourselves here in this place, if we look at the banner on the way out as we head towards the door, Galatians 6, verse 10, "As we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are of the household, of the family of faith." That is, this is for their benefit, because it helps them. But those works of mercy for the brethren also are testimonies to us that we are in Christ. For St. John tells us in his first epistle, "We know that we have passed from death to life because we love the brethren." And notice the way the sheep in the parable are commended, or specifically, what acts of love and mercy are commended in their love for the brethren. They're simple works of mercy. The sheep gave food to a brother or sister who was hungry. They gave drink to the one who thirsted. The sheep took strangers into their homes, not just any stranger, but strangers who were brothers in need. They clothed the naked so that they wouldn't suffer exposure or the shame of nakedness. The sheep visited the brethren in their homes as they were sick, in the hospital, in the rehab facility, in the nursing home, to encourage them in Christ, to commit their souls to Him in doing good as a faithful Creator. These aren't big works in the eyes of the world. They're not grandiose. They're not lavish. They're not fantastic works that all men can see. And that's because they're done in love. And what does St. Paul say about love? Love does not parade itself and is not puffed up. Love does not seek its own. Christ commends these simple works of mercy because they are done in love for one another. The size of the work doesn't matter. What matters is the love for the brethren, the love for Christ that motivates the work and animates the heart. Again, this is why the goats have no works to testify to any faith. They don't love the brethren because they themselves are not Christ's brothers through faith. And not being sons of God and brothers of Christ Jesus by faith, they have no work of love in God's sight. For St. Paul says in Romans 14, whatever is not of faith is sin. So what do we, as His beloved, do with all this? The collect of the day fleshes this out for us really well. We pray, and ought to pray every day, O God, so rule and govern our hearts and minds by Thy Holy Spirit, that, being ever mindful of the end of all things and the day of Thy just judgment, may be stirred up to holiness of living here and dwell with Thee forever hereafter. Keep us mindful of the end of all things. Remind our hearts each day of His righteous judgment so that we don't fall to the temptation to live as those who are willfully negligent and ignorant of the fact that He will come again, that there is an end to all things, and that at that end there is a judgment. Keep us mindful of that so that we stir ourselves up to holiness of living, not to earn our salvation, because that is gifted to us as an inheritance, but because holy conduct is how we please our Father in heaven. With the end in mind, and Jesus' words, those of you in Bible study will remember them, he who endures until the end shall be saved, we pray each day that God grows our faith exceedingly. We pray each day that as our faith grows exceedingly, our love for one another may abound, and that we then grow in exercising self-control in mind and body as well, so that we are preserved in the righteousness that Christ gives us. We pray that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may live with the end in mind, trusting in Christ's mercy, loving our neighbors, looking forward to hearing those words of Christ. Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which far surpasses all human understanding, guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.